physical only cells. These cells are not present in the design netlist. If the name of a cell is not present in the current design, it will consider as physical only cells. They do not appear on timing paths reports. They are typically invented for finishing the chip. The list shown below are the physical only cells, which has end cap cells, tap cells, decap cells, filler cells, tie cells, and spare cells. End cap cells doesn't have any timing model and contains only base layers. This cell usually placed at the standard cell row start and end. This will have VDD and VSS. These are added to know the start and end of the row. End cap cells are placed to avoid the cell damage at the start and end of the row to avoid wrong layer wavelength for correct manufacturing. During fabrication, poly variation is more at the edges. To account for the poly variation, dummy cells are inserted at the edges of the row so that manufacturing defects are reduced. During etching process, undesigned portion from the surface of a wafer is chemically removed, and that should not affect the standard cells present in the design. So by adding end cap cells, prevent such damages. It also used to address boundary N-well issues for DRC cleanup. It checks whether N-well are properly terminated. Tap cells used to prevent latch up. This cell connects the power VDD and ground VSS to the N-well and substrate, that is N-well to VDD and P-substrate to VSS. It ensures N-well substrate continuity in the design. By placing well taps at regular intervals in design, the N-well potential is held constant for proper electrical functionality. It gives reverse bias to the N-well and P-well. The spacing between the well tap insertion in the design will vary according to the technologies. As I told you, tap cells are used to prevent latch up. The interviewer may ask you about what is latch up. So you can simply answer, latch up refers to short circuit formed between power and ground rails in an IC, leading to high current and damage to the IC. Latch up is a phenomena of low impedance path between power rail and ground rail due to interaction between parasitic NPN and PNP transistors. Decap cells. Decap cells are temporary capacitors which are added in the design between power and ground rails to encounter the functionality failure due to dynamic IR drop. Dynamic IR drop happens at the active edge of the clock at which a high current is drawn from the power grid for a small duration. To avoid the dynamic IR drop, charge store in the cell and release the charge to nets. If power source is far from a flop, the chances are there that flop can go into metastable state. To overcome, decaps are added. When current requirement is high, these decaps discharge and provide boost to the power grid. It is used to remove ground bounce and power bounce. Ground bounce is reduced by placing the more ground IO pads than power pads. Decap cells are normally poly-gate transistors where source and drain are connected to the ground rail and the gate is connected to the power rail. More decap cells, then more leakage also will be there. Decap cells are placed as filler cells in the design. Filler cells. Filling 100% of area with normal cells is impossible. Filler cells are used to connect the gaps between the cells after placement. They don't have the functionality and are used to fill the spaces to prevent the base layer DRC violations. Filler cells are used to establish the continuity of N-well and the implant layers on the standard cell rows. Some of the cells also don't have the bulk connection, the substrate connection, because of their small size, thin cells. In those cases, the abutment of cells through inserting filler cells can connect those substrates of small cells to the power ground nets. Those thin cells can use the bulk connection of the other cells. This one of the reason why you get standalone LVS check failed on some cells. Generally, after placement and rounding stage and before LVS and DRC check, these cells are added in the design. If not added, then power ground open occurs between the standard cells. Tie cells. Tie cells are used for preventing damage of cells. Tie high cells. Here, gate 1 input is connected to VDD, another input is connected to signal net. And tie low cells. Here, gate 1 input is connected to VSS and another input is connected to signal net. I use to connect the gate of the transistor to either power or ground. Directly we cannot connect the pins to VDD or VSS. It has to go through tie cells. Tie cells are used to enable the logic 0, logic 1 connection. Tie cell should be directly driving and it should not be buffered. In lower technology nodes, if the gate is connected to power or ground, the transistor might be turned on or off due to power or ground bounce. These cells are part of the standard cell library. The cell which require VDD, typically constant signal tied to 1, connect to high cells. The cells which require VSS and VDD, typically constant signal tied to 0, connect to tie low cells. These cells are part of the standard cell library. Spared cells. Spared cells are used to implement ECO, engineering change order, after base 2 and before metal 2. If any bugs reported or found after the tape out, we can use these spare cells to fix the bugs. Spare cells act as redundant cells. The key is having spare cells in your design is that you only need to change the metal layers in order to rewire the logic and fix any bugs. This means you only need to pay for new metal mask, thus saving money. The spare cells input must be tied to VDD VSS and output pins left floating. When these cells are required, their inputs are disconnected from VDD VSS and connected to functional logic in ECO mode. Spare cells are nothing but the standard cells and are placed randomly across the chip for later use. Spare cells are standard cells in a design that are not used by the netlist. There would be inclusion of approximately 5% of spare cells in the whole design. Not more than that. It basically reduces the mask preparation cost.